Hello, I welcome my YouTube channel. I am Dr. Sharanbasappa Chikkali, Assistant Professor of Commerce. Dear friends, we have discussed profitability ratios in relation to sales in my ratio analysis part 4 video. At present in this video, that is ratio analysis part 5, where I am going to discuss about profitability ratios in relation to investments. I request you like this video and subscribe my YouTube channel for further commerce and management topics related videos. Profitability of a business may be measured in relation to sales and in relation to investment. Profitability in relation to sales indicates the amount of profit per rupee of sales. Similarly, profitability in relation to investments indicates the amount of profit per rupee invested in assets. The first ratio of profitability ratios in relation to investment is return on capital employed, or it is also called it as return on investment. The ratio establishes the relationship between total capital and net operating profit of the business. The purpose of this ratio is to find out whether capital employed is effectively utilized or not. Capital employed includes shareholders fund and long-term loan. The formula for calculating return on capital employed is profit before interest and taxes divided by capital employed and multiplied with the 100. The return on capital employed ratio reveals how well the resources of a firm are being used. Higher the ratio, better are the results. The return on shareholders' investment should be compared with the return of other similar firm in the same industry. The inter-firm comparison of this ratio determines whether the investment in the firm are attractive or not, as the investor would like to invest only where the return is higher. The term capital employed refers to the total investment made in business and can be defined in a number of ways. The three most widely used definitions of the term capital employed are, first one, gross capital employed, second, net capital employed, and third, sum total of long-term funds. Gross capital employed refers fixed assets plus investments plus current assets, where net capital employed refers fixed assets, investments plus net working capital. Here net working capital means current assets minus current liabilities. So in gross capital employed, we have taken current assets total, but here we are not taken current asset as it is, but we are deducted current liabilities out of the current assets, and rest the amount is referred as net working capital and it is added to the investment and fixed assets. That refers to the net capital employed. The third one, the sum total of long-term funds. So where capital employed refers share capital plus reserves and surplus plus long-term loans minus fictitious assets minus non-business assets. In managerial decisions, the term capital employed is generally used in the meaning given in the third point above, that is sum total of long-term funds. To calculate the return on capital employed, the formula is profit before interest and taxes divided by capital employed and multiplied by 100. So let us see how to calculate the capital employed. For the calculation of capital employed, we have two ways. The one is asset approach method and other is liability approach method. Under asset approach method, we calculate capital employed taking net fixed assets and adding the current assets and deducting the current liabilities. The remaining amount is referred as capital employed. This is the way of calculating the capital employed under asset approach method. Let us see how to calculate the capital employed under liability approach. So under this method, we take first total liability and deduct intangible assets and fictitious assets and current liabilities, and the rest amount is referred as capital employed. This is the another approach to calculate the capital employed. This is called net liability approach method. Here we should remember that while calculating capital employed, idle assets, intangible assets, absolute assets and absolute stock, investment outside the business, fictitious assets like accumulated losses, discount on issue of shares or debentures, preliminary expenses should be excluded while calculating the capital employed. And after knowing the how to ascertain the capital employed, the next we will understand how to ascertain profit before interest and taxes. Here the specimen for calculating the profit before interest and taxes, the first we have to take sales and deduct variable cost. The answer is referred as contribution. When out of the contribution, fixed cost is deducted, this answer is called as earning before interest and taxes. This figure we should use for the calculating return on capital employed. Out of the earnings before interest and tax, When we deduct interest, the remaining answer is referred earnings before tax. And out of this, when tax is deducted, the answer is referred earnings after tax. Out of this amount, when preference dividend is deducted, the last figure is referred as earnings available to equity shareholders. Let us see an example for calculation of return on capital employed. From the following information, calculate return on capital employed. The share capital is 2 lakh equity shares of rupees 10 each. The total amount is 20 lakh. General reserve 15,000 rupees. Profit and loss account balance is 5 lakh. 15% debentures, 30 lakh rupees is the amount. Profit before tax is 14 lakh rupees and provision for tax is 5 lakh rupees. So let us see the solution for the calculating return on capital employed. The formula for return on capital employed is profit before interest and taxes divided by capital employed, and it is multiplied by 100. Let us ascertain the profit before interest and taxes. So here in this problem, profit before tax is 14 lakh rupees given in the problem. But when profit before tax means the interest is already deducted. So we have to add back the interest on debentures. Here the debenture amount is 30 lakh rupees and its interest rate is 15%. 30 lakh 15% means 4 lakh 50 thousand rupees. When we add this interest back to the profit before tax, 4 lakh 50 thousand rupees to 14 lakh rupees, then answer is 18 lakh 50 thousand rupees. It refers profit before interest and taxes. So here 18 lakh 50 thousand is the profit before interest and taxes. After ascertaining the profit before interest and taxes, now let us calculate the capital employed. Here the capital employed defined as the sum total of long-term funds. Under that, share capital, reserves and surplus and profit and loss account and debentures are added. The total amount of these four items are 70 lakh rupees. And we put into the formula to calculate return. So here 18 lakh 50 thousand rupees is the profit before interest and taxes as we calculated here. And capital employed is 70 lakh rupees. And multiplied with the 100, the answer is 26.43%. So it means the return on capital employed is 26.43% in this firm. Let us see the second ratio, return on shareholders fund. It is the ratio of net profit after interest and taxes to shareholders fund. It is calculated to find out the profitability of the firm from the shareholders point of view. The formula for return on shareholder fund is net profit after interest and taxes divided by shareholders fund. In earlier case, we have calculated net profit before interest and tax, but for the calculation of return on shareholders fund, we are taking net profit after interest and tax divided by shareholders fund, and it is multiplied with the 100 to express the answer into percentage. Here the shareholders fund includes equity share capital, preference share capital and reserves and surplus, and out of these three, accumulated losses are deducted to arrive the shareholders fund. The third one is return on equity shareholders fund. In real sense, we know equity shareholders are the real owners of the company. As they take high risk, they expect more return. To know the rate of return, the return on equity shareholders are calculated. This ratio establishes the relationship between the net profit available to equity shareholders and the amount of capital invested by them. It is calculated to find out the profitability of the firm from the equity shareholders' point of view, and the formula for it, net profit after tax and preference dividend. It also refers earnings available to equity shareholders divided by equity shareholders fund, and it is multiplied with the 100. This ratio indicates the profit percentage for equity shareholders. A high rate of return on equity shareholders fund makes happy to existing equity shareholders, also attracts the prospective investors, and in turn increases the shares price in the market. Let us see an example to understand the return on shareholders fund and return on equity shareholders fund. Here 2000 equity shares capital of rupees 100 each. The total amount is 2 lakh rupees, and 1000 8% preference shares of rupees 100 each, and the preference share capital is 1 lakh rupees. And the reserves and surplus consist revenue reserves 30,000 rupees, capital reserve 50,000 rupees, and reserve for contingencies 20,000 rupees. The total reserves and surplus is 1 lakh rupees. The net profit before interest and tax is 1,50,000 rupees and interest charge is 30,000 rupees and the tax rate is 50%. And we are going to calculate the return on shareholders fund and return on equity shareholders. So let us see the first for the calculation, return on shareholders fund. The formula for it, net profit after interest and tax. But here they have given in the problem net profit before, but we need after interest and tax, but they have provided net profit before interest and tax. So out of this amount, we have to deduct interest and tax to arrive net profit after interest and tax. So let us see how to calculate the net profit after interest and tax. Earning before interest and tax 1,50,000 rupees. Out of this amount, we deduct interest, that is given 30,000 rupees in the problem. The remaining is called earnings after interest. After deducting the interest, next we should deduct the tax. The tax rate is 50% and it is calculated on earnings after interest, that is 1,20,000 rupees. On 1,20,000 rupees, 50% means 60,000 rupees. After deducting the tax, 60,000 rupees. The earnings after interest and tax is 60,000 rupees. So next we have to calculate the shareholders fund. The shareholders fund means equity of 2 lakh rupees, preference shares of rupees 1 lakh and reserves and surplus total amount is 1 lakh rupees. The total is 4 lakh rupees. Here net profit after interest and tax is 60,000 rupees as it is calculated here. And the shareholder fund is 4 lakh rupees and multiplied with 100. The rate of return on shareholders fund is 15%. So let us see the next one, return on equity shareholders. The formula for it is net profit after tax and preference dividend. It is also referred as earnings available to equity shareholders and divided by equity shareholders fund. So let us see how to calculate the earnings available to equity shareholders fund. This is how the earnings available to equity shareholders are calculated. We have taken first earnings before interest and tax 1,50,000 rupees. We deducted interest 30,000 rupees and next we deducted 50% tax 60,000 rupees. The remaining amount is 60,000. This is earning after interest and tax that we are used for calculating the return on shareholders fund. So after reaching this one, next we have to deduct the preference dividend. As the preference capital is 1 lakh rupees and the rate of dividend is 8%. So 1 lakh rupees, 8% means 8,000 is the dividend on preference share capital. So out of 60,000 rupees, 8,000 deducted. The remaining 52,000 is referred earnings available to equity shareholders or net profit after tax and preference dividend. So let us calculate equity shareholders fund. It is similar to the shareholders fund only, but here we are not considering the preference share capital. Equity 2 lakh rupees and reserves 1 lakh rupees. The total equity shareholders fund is 3 lakh rupees. So 52,000 rupees divided by 3 lakh multiplied with the 100. The answer is 17.33. That is, return to the equity shareholders is 17.33% in this case. Let us understand the next ratio, earnings per share, and it is shortly called it as EPS. It measures the profit available to equity shareholders per share, that is the amount that they get for every share held. It is an important ratio from the equity shareholders point of view, as this ratio affects the market price of share and the amount of dividend to be given to the equity shareholders. The formula is net profit after tax minus preference dividend divided by number of equity shares. The earnings per share is useful in determining the market price of equity share and capacity of the company to pay dividend. A comparison of earnings per share with another company helps to know whether the equity capital is effectively used in the business or not. So here is an example to understand earning per share. The net profit before tax is 5 lakh rupees. Equity share capital 10 lakh rupees at the rate of 20 per share. The tax rate is 40% of net profit and 5,000, 8% preference shares of rupees 100 each. Let us calculate the earning per share with this example. The formula is net profit after tax and preference dividend. As I told earlier, this is also called it as earnings available to equity shareholders. Now let us calculate the earnings available to equity shareholders. The earnings before interest and tax is 5 lakh rupees as it is mentioned in this problem. There is no interest figure in the problem, so we have left it. And next, tax 40% on 5 lakh rupees, that is net profit. is 2 lakh rupees. We deducted tax 2 lakh rupees. And after, it is referred as earnings after tax 3 lakh rupees. The next, we have to deduct the preference dividend. Here, the preference dividend amount is 5,000 shares multiplied with the 100 each. It means 5 lakh rupees. And 5 lakh rupees, 8% means 40,000 rupees is the preference dividend. So when we deduct 40,000 rupees preference dividend, the earnings available to equity shareholders are 2,60,000 rupees. Now we have to calculate number of equity shares. The total capital belongs to the equity shareholders are 10 lakh rupees. This 10 lakh rupees are divided by the face value, that is 20. We get the number of equity shares, that is 50,000. And the 2,60,000 rupees is the amount available to equity shareholders and their number is 50,000. The earning per share is rupees 5.20. It means every share is earning rupees 5.20. The next ratio is price earning ratio. It is the ratio which expresses the relationship between market price per share and earning per share. In other words, indicates the number of times the earning per share is covered by the market price. The formula for earning per share is market price per equity share divided by earning per share. This ratio acts as a guide to an investor for estimating the market price of his shares to decide whether to buy shares of a company or not. It explains to earn 1 rupee how much amount should invest in a particular company. The next one is earning yield ratio. This ratio describes the relationship of a company's last 12 months earnings per share to the company's current share price per share. The earnings yield ratio is the reverse ratio of the PE ratio and it is expressed in terms of percentage. In PE ratio, market price per equity share is divided by earning per share, but in earnings yield ratio, earning per share is divided by the market price per share. It is just reverse of the price earning ratio. This earnings yield ratio explains the percentage of return on market price share in relation to the earning per share. The next is dividend payout ratio. It is calculated to know the amount of earnings retained in the business, which reduces the cost of capital and increases the rate of dividend payable to the equity shareholders. Another other ratio is overall dividend cover ratio. This ratio indicates how many times the preference dividend and equity are covered by the net profit after tax. The formula is net profit after tax divided by preference dividend plus equity dividend. The next is preference dividend coverage ratio. This ratio shows the number of times the preference dividend is covered by the net profit after tax. The formula is the net profit after tax divided by annual preference dividend. And the next is equity dividend cover. This ratio shows the number of times the equity dividend paid is covered by the profit available to equity shareholders. The formula is earnings available to equity shareholders divided by dividend paid to equity shareholders. And the next one is interest coverage ratio. This ratio indicates whether the earnings of the firm are sufficient to pay interest charges periodically or not. The formula for this one is profit before interest and tax divided by fixed interest charges. Here, fixed interest charges refers interest on debentures plus interest on loan taken. Let us see an example. The capital of Lakshmi Limited is as follows. The 9% preference shares of rupees 100 each. The capital amount of preference share is 4 lakh rupees. Equity shares of rupees 10 each. The capital amount is 10 lakh. Reserves and surplus is 1 lakh rupees. The accountant has ascertained the following information. Profit before tax 6,75,000 rupees and the tax rate is 40%. Market price per share is 40 rupees and equity dividend paid is 25%. So you are required to calculate earning per share. We will solve one by one these ratios. The first we will calculate earning per share. The formula for earning per share is earning available to equity shareholders divided by number of equity shares. The calculation of earnings available to equity shareholders. The first earnings before interest and tax is 6,75,000 rupees. The interest amount is not there in this problem. So it means there is no any debt source are used in this firm. The next tax 40% is deducted. 40% tax is calculated on 6,75,000 rupees. The amount is 2,70,000 is tax and 4,05,000 represents earning after tax. And out of earnings after tax, the next preference dividend is deducted. The preference dividend is 9% on 4 lakh rupees, that is 36,000 rupees. Earnings available to equity shareholder amount is 3,69,000 rupees, and the number of equity shares are calculated taking the capital amount 10 lakh rupees and divided by the face value of the equity shares, that is 10 rupees, and number of equity shares is 1 lakh. 3,69,000 is the earning available to equity shareholders, and divided by number of equity shareholders 1 lakh, the earning per share rupees is 3.69. So it means every share is earning 3.69 rupees. The next ratio is price earning ratio. Price earning ratio formula is market price per equity shares divided by earning per share. Here the market price is given in the problem is 40 rupees. 40 is the current market price of the equity and divided by earning per share as it is calculated 3.69 in this problem. The P ratio is 10.84. So it means to earn 1 rupee, investor has to invest 10.84 rupees in this particular firm. In other words, when the investor invests 10.84 rupees in this firm, he will earn 1 rupee. The next is earnings yield ratio. The formula for earning yield ratio is earning per share divided by market price per share. Earning per share is 3.69 divided by market price is 40. It is just reverse of this price earning ratio. The answer is 9.23%. It means the earning yield in this firm is 9.23 when earning per share is compared with the market price per share. The fourth one is dividend yield ratio. The formula for dividend yield ratio is dividend per share divided by market value per share. The dividend per share is calculated as we have taken the face value of the equity shares, that is 10 rupees, and they have mentioned equity dividend paid is 25%. The 25% on the face value of the equity 10 rupees is 2.5. This is the dividend per share 2.5 and divided by market value per share is 40 rupees and multiplied with the 100, the answer is 6.25%. The fifth one is the dividend payout ratio. The ratio for it, dividend per share divided by earning per share. Dividend per share already calculated in previous 2.5 divided by, and earning per share is also calculated 3.69 and multiplied with the 100. The answer is 67.75%. It means out of the earning per share, the 67.75% is distributed as dividend. The sixth one is market value to book value ratio. The formula is market value per share divided by book value per share. The market value per share, as it is given in the problem 40, we need to calculate the book value per share. The book value per share is equity plus reserves and surplus minus goodwill minus accumulated losses divided by number of equity shares. This is the way to calculate the book value per share. Here, the equity and reserves are given 10 lakh rupees equity and reserve is 1 lakh rupees and divided by number of equity shares 1 lakh rupees. The book value per share is rupees 11. The market value 40 and divided by book value 11 rupees. The answer is 3.64 times. It means market value 3.64 times is more when compared to the book value per share. The next one, overall dividend cover ratio. The formula for that is net profit after tax divided by preference dividend plus equity dividend. And net profit after tax is calculated here. Earnings before interest and tax 6,75,000 minus interest. There is no interest amount. Deduct tax 40%, that is 2,70,000 rupees. Earning after tax is 4,05,000. And next we should calculate preference dividend and equity dividend. Preference dividend, 4 lakh is the preference capital and the rate of dividend is 9%. And the preference dividend amount is 36,000. Equity dividend, the capital of equity shareholder is 10 lakh and 25% equity dividend paid. 25% and 10 lakh is 2,50,000 rupees. So 4,05,000 rupees is earnings after tax and preference dividend 36,000 rupees and equity dividend 2,50,000 rupees. And the answer is 1.42 times. It means the company's net profit after tax covers preference dividend and equity dividend. That is, overall dividend coverage ratio is 1.42 times. The next 8th one is preference dividend ratio. The formula for that, net profit after tax divided by preference dividend. as net profit after tax is calculated 4,05,000 rupees and preference dividend is also calculated 36,000 rupees. The answer for preference dividend is 11.25 times. So it means the net profit after tax of this firm covers 11.25 times of the preference dividend. The next is equity dividend ratio. The formula is the net profit after tax divided by equity dividend. The net profit after tax is 4,05,000 rupees divided by equity dividend is 2,50,000. The answer is 1.62 times. It means the company's profit is covers 1.62 times of the equity dividend. Dear friends, I hope this video class helped you a lot to understand the profitability ratios in relation to the investment. In the next video, I am going to discuss the solvency ratios. Please like this video and subscribe my YouTube channel. Thank you.